Okay, it's rolling.
Awesome. Hey, hi.
I'm Hallie.
Hi, Hallie.
So I've got a couple of questions about your application for the ADA Dark Sky Association and Dark Sky Park.
Okay.
And about light pollution on animal byland and how you deal with it.
Okay.
Stuff like that.
Sure, cool.
So my first question is, how does the light pollution on the Wasatch Front affect the animal
violent,
like, stars.
Dark skies?
Yeah.
Yeah, so we definitely see the light pollution from the Salt Lake area. Basically, you know, from Ogden all the way down to Salt Lake. When you look out at night, when you look to the west, or east, which is where the Wasatch Front is, you can see that light pollution. It goes up probably halfway up the sky. There's actually a kind of a dome of light right there. But when you look to the west, out over the lake, it's very dark. So you've got, you know, areas of the night sky where you can look straight up and then kind of to the west, and it's nice and dark. And then you look up and it's dark, and then you start to lose some of those stars on the east over there. So it definitely affects it. We definitely see that glow over here. But I think we're far enough away that we're able to still get that dark sky designation, right? So we don't have some of the darkest skies in the world, but we have some pretty dark skies, dark enough that the IDA said, yep, that's a pretty good night sky.
Okay, so my second question is, how does light pollution affect any of the animals on the park?
On the park, not too much, just because it's far enough away that the light from the city doesn't really affect it too much, and there's enough space on the west side that animals can get away. But we do have a lot of nocturnal animals. We have a lot of owls.
Yeah.
We have coyotes. We have rabbits. So a lot of those animals rely on those dark skies. But I think we have enough dark areas on the park that they can kind of behave naturally. So they have places where they can nest and places where they can den away from the city light.
Okay. Do you think the dark skies affect in a good way on the community of the Wasatch Front and people who, I've seen people who camp on animal violence? Mm-hmm. Do you think it?
Yeah, so I think that people are starting to realize how important dark skies are, you know, when they realize that there are places where they can see the Milky Way, but they can't from their own neighborhood, right? And so they're looking for places to get out and to see those stars in the Milky Way. And so having some place like Antelope Island so close to, you know, 2 million people along the Wasatch Front is really, really cool, because they can just drive an hour and be out here and see things that they've never seen before, right?
Yeah.
And so I think that it helps expand our imagination. It helps us to pay more attention to the other things that live in an area, that we're not just, it's not just me going to work or going to school, right? That there's plants and there's animals and there's birds, and all those things rely on those dark skies. And I think having this right here, Antelope Island, maybe helps people think about that a little bit more. And hopefully, I mean, one of my goals is that it helps people think about their own light in their own yards to see if we can, you know, shield those lights and help protect the night sky, even in your own neighborhood. So that's one of my goals with having a dark sky park right here close to the Wasatch Front.
Yeah, it's really convenient. I love being out here and just being out, and it's like so remote. And I think it said somewhere in the application that I think either you or somebody in a letter said that it was so close but yet so remote, and it was like really nice.
Yeah.
I really agree with that.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people come out here, even in the daytime, day or night, they'll come out and they'll be like, I know I'm only 7 minutes from the city, but I feel like I'm in another place. You know, some people would say another world, because it's so remote.
Yeah.
And it's still so rugged, right? There's not a lot of development, there's not a lot of light, there's not a lot of cell phone reception or internet, right? So it really feels like you're remote, and that, I think, helps people connect a little bit more to the place where they're in.
Yeah. Okay, so my next question is, what role do parks play in limiting light pollution?
So parks in general in Utah The Utah State Parks is developing a dark sky initiative, so that a lot of state parks are trying to get that dark sky designation. And I think there are 43 state parks, 44 state parks, and having a good number of those reaching out to their communities to say, hey, this is really important. It's important for the economy, it's important for the area, it's important for the wildlife. So having all those places throughout the state trying to get that dark sky designation, I think over time will have a really positive impact on the level of light pollution in the state. I probably forgot your question. Ask your question again, make sure I answer it.
What role do parks play in limiting light pollution?
Yeah, and then so each individual park, in order to get that designation, has to play a part, right? So mm-hmm. they'll have to change out their own light bulbs. We still have light fixtures here that we're working on changing, but we've changed about 80% of them so that they're all dark sky compliant. And the rest of them, they get turned off for most of the year. So when you come out at night, it's really dark. And I think, so all the state parks and national parks and cities and camp communities that are doing that are creating safer environments, because it's not that we're saying turn off all lights. The dark sky is saying let's use lights right,
yeah.
effectively and efficiently, so that it saves money and it saves the night sky. So by doing that, I think we're hopefully being an example to the communities that we're in to look at ways that they can do that as well.
Okay, so this is about, now this next set of questions is about the certificate for the dark sky bioland.
Mm-hmm.
So my first question in that category is, what led Animal Bioland to apply for the dark sky certificate, and how did the idea to get an international dark sky certificate develop?
So it actually started probably in 2013. I was doing a thing called Globe at Night, where you try to kind of look at the night sky and do programming that helps the public learn about the night sky. And then my supervisor learned about it as he was on a flight to China or something. He was visiting with somebody who was part of the IDA. And so then he sent me an email and said, hey, we should look into this. I said, yeah, good idea. And then I thought, man, we're so close to the Wasatch Front. There's so much light pollution. I don't know if we could qualify, right? So I kind of let it sit on the back burner. And then two state parks, Dead Horse Point State Park and Goblin Valley State Park, both started working towards dark sky designation. And one of their park employees said, hey, you should really look into this. And you should see if Animal Bioland could qualify. So the more I looked into it, I thought, okay, I'll just go ahead and go, through the process. I'll look at all of our lights. Because we qualified it in most ways. We were already doing dark sky programming. We already had Access After Dark. So all those things, I thought, well, we could probably give it a shot. So we did. It took about a year to put the application together. And then when we submitted it, we blew through with flying colors. So we did a lot of work ahead of time, a year's worth of work to change out light bulbs and to do programming and to reach out to the community, because a lot of that was you had to have community support. So you couldn't just do this and just be like, I'm going to do it, and just be in my little bubble. The community had to kind of be involved and say, yeah, we support that. So we got the community support as well.
Yeah, your application has a letter from the Ogden Valley Starry Nights, and it was an application letter.
Uh-huh.
And so I thought that was kind of cool how you got that nomination letter from somebody else in the community.
Yeah, and that's the way you have to do it. If you want to become a dark sky park, you have to have a nomination letter from somebody from the IDA. And Janet Muir, that's who that letter was from. I reached out to her, and she was really happy to help with that whole process. So she was happy to write that letter, and that was a really important key point in that, is to get that support from the IDA itself.
Yeah. Has the dark sky certification changed the park's management plan?
Yeah, it has a little bit. One of the requirements was that in our management plan, it has to specifically list that dark skies is a priority and that it's one of the natural resources that we are going to protect. Ours didn't say that, so we had to create an attachment or an addendum to our plan, saying, this is a priority, and this is one thing that we're going to manage the park for. So we had to make that change. We had to change out a lot of our lights, like I said, and we had to make sure that the park was accessible after dark, so that people could come after dark and stay out later than normal to watch the night sky. So we started allowing people to stay, even after the gates close at night, to stay for a few hours after that to be able to watch the night sky. So we've had to change a little bit of those kinds of things in order to become that dark sky place.
Did you have to make changes to the park lighting? I think we mentioned this before. Mm-hmm. During the application process, what other changes did you have to make?
So in addition to changing out some of the lights, that was the main thing. So changing out the lights and the light fixtures, and then just verifying our park entrance hours so that we could make sure that people were okay letting people stay later. That was really the main thing, because one of the requirements was that we do programming at least 4 times a year. We were already doing that. We probably do 20 dark sky programs every year, so we were already doing that. We were already doing a lot of those things that were required. So it was mainly the lights and the park access after dark that we had to work on.
Yeah. I saw the star parties,
mm-hmm.
and the next star party is coming up,
mm-hmm.
I think,
yep.
And I might be going.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's once a month, so I think it's May 22nd is the next one, and there's one in June, and then there's one in August, September, and October.
Yeah, I'm excited.
Yeah, cool.
I'm glad that you do those programs.
Yeah.
It really is.
Yeah, and a lot of people come out who have never been out before and look through a telescope.
Yeah.
And when you can look through a telescope and see Saturn and the Saturn's rings, right? That's so cool. That's my favorite thing to look at. I mean, there's so many things you can look at. You can look at galaxies and globular clusters and nebula and all those things. But when you can see Saturn and you can see the rings around Saturn, it's super cool. So I love that when Saturn is up and people can come and see those things, because then they actually realize what's out there and what they might be missing by having so much light pollution.
Can you explain some of the measurements mentioned in the application? For example, the Bortle class?
Mm-hmm. So the Bortle class was created by, his last name was Bortle, I don't know his first name, you probably know, but I don't.
I think it was John Bortle, I think. Maybe. John.
Maybe. Anyway. And so he was the first guy to kind of look at the sky and say, we need a way to figure out how dark it is. And so he came up with the Bortle scale, where 1 is the darkest night skies, 0 light pollution, all the way up to 9, which is basically a really, really bright city like Los Angeles, where you can't see any stars except for maybe the brightest ones or a planet. I worked with the Ogden Astronomical Society, and we went out a few nights and looked up at the sky, and based on the stars that you can see, the dimmest stars that you can see, the brightest stars that you can see, came up that we're right around the Bortle class 4, which is not the darkest, but definitely far from the brightest. So there's that measurement. There's also the dark sky meter. So in the application, it talks about the SQML meters, and so
mm-hmm.
that's this guy right here. So on a new moon, when the moon's not out, we go outside into different spots in the park, and we measure how dark the sky is with this. So this tells you the smaller the number, the brighter the star, the sky, and then the bigger the number, the darker the sky. And so you saw in the application that we were right around 20.8 to 20.6, I don't remember exactly. And it's a really easy way you measure. You just point it at the top of the point of the sky, and then you hold it, and it gives you, it gives you a number. So in here it's 5.9. So really, really low, which means it's really, really bright, right?
Yeah.
So when we go outside and we do that, we just hold it up and we just hold it and do our measurement, and then it gives us the number. And so if we do that all over the park, it will tell us how dark the night skies are. And if we're losing that darkness or if it's getting darker. So maybe after a while, if the communities are like, hey, we need to do this, that will start to reflect in the numbers that we get when we go out and do our measurements.
Can you tell me how the unicantered sky quality meters work?
That's what that is, right there. Yep, that's what that one is. Yep. So that's what, and I don't know how it works, but that's what it does. That's what it tells us. So when I did that, most of the readings were anywhere from 20.3 to, I think one time I even got a 21-something, which was really cool. But right around 20.6 or 20.8 is where that ends up landing. So that's what that is. So there was a boil class, there was this, and then there was one more light pollution indicator. I forgot what it was called. But again, that one is based on the dimmest stars you can see. And then use, because each star has a rating measurement. Like the really, really bright stars are like classified as 1, and then the really dim stars are classified as 6. So if you can see a 1 or a -1, or you can see a 6 or a 5 or a 4, you know, because they're really dim, if you can see those bigger numbered stars, then you have a really dark sky, because the darker it is, the more stars you can see. So we use that as well to see what's the dimmest star we can see in this part of the sky, and that's how we measure that. And I'm sorry, I don't remember the name of that measurement. But.
How did you pick the locations to measure them?
Mainly I thought about where the public goes. So where could, if I was a park visitor, where would I go to see the night sky? So I picked those spots, which are mostly on this north end of the island, and on the west side, White Rock Bay is right behind us, and that's where we do those star parties. So I picked a couple in that spot. And then beyond that, I went down the east side, where you could see the city lights really well, so that we could get kind of an overall idea of how dark the overall skies were. And then I tried to find places on the west side, way on the back side, that's most protected from the city lights, and took measurements from there, just to try to get an overall average of how dark the skies were. So it was really just me thinking about, you know, where people go and where can I get the brightest readings and where can I get the darkest readings so we can average those out and get a pretty accurate reading.
What are the differences in the gold, silver, and bronze designations?
It's really a measure of that unihedron sky quality meter that I used. The gold are the biggest numbers in that. So I think to reach gold, you have to be like 21.5 or something like that average. And then silver is between 21 and 21.5, and then bronze is up, 20 to 21, right in there. So it's using that sky quality meter is the difference between gold, silver, and bronze. And so gold are the really, really dark, dark, dark nights where there's, maybe the closest city is maybe 50 miles away, and all the places around you have really good dark sky lighting. So those are going to be gold, like Goblin Valley State Park or Goosenecks State Park, way down in the middle of nowhere. Those would be gold star. And the silver is somewhere in between that and us.
Which one is yellow?
Bronze. We got the bronze tier. Yeah.
How long did that vacation take? You said a year. When was yellow violet's certificate awarded?
So we got ours in April of last year, so April 2017 was when we got the official thumbs up and we got the designation.
That's cool.
Yeah.
How does Amel Byland's status as a dark sky park change its appeal for stargazers?
I think it changes it a lot. So there are people who are looking for dark sky places. Some travelers who plan their travels around where they can see the darkest skies. And so now that we are officially a dark sky park, and we show up on the International Dark Sky Association's website as dark sky parks, people will use that to plan their trips. And so we've seen a lot more increase in night sky photographers and requests for astronomy programs. We've had, just last month, we had, I think, 3 different universities come out with their astronomy clubs to do some dark sky photography and dark sky astronomy. So it's increased our after hours visitation a lot more. So a lot more interest from the public and from the community and from universities heading out to try to find dark sky places. So it's definitely increased that visitation for dark sky and that interest in dark sky places from the community.
Are you glad that Antelope Island is now a dark sky park?
Yeah. I am. I think it's really important. I think dark skies are one of those natural resources that we often overlook. You know, we think about water and air and land, trees and grass and wildlife. And dark skies are a natural resource, and I think it just makes sense that a state park or a national park, that's one of the things that we're protecting because we are starting to lose it. And it's, you know, I mean, you know, you've been out, and when you see the night sky, it's just full of wonder, right? You can just like dream big and think big, and it's amazing that we can see so many stars, and I think it's really important that we don't lose that, that we don't lose that opportunity to wonder and to dream, and that we don't, you know, that we protect that natural resource for us and for you and for your kids and, you know, just for years to come, that we have those dark skies. So I'm really excited that we have that, and I hope that even when I'm gone, the people who were managing the park will see that it's important as well and keep working on creating dark skies. Maybe you can be here, right? And you'll be in charge of creating dark skies.
Let's see.
2 different papers, so we can have the same questions on.
So, when it said in the application that the Archaeological Society helped you measure some of the areas and how the dark sky, all that stuff, and it said data and maps and all this other stuff, how long did it take you? Is it just like how you showed me where you just hold it up?
Yeah, it really is not too hard. You just find it, you just have to have a dark night. That's why it took, you know, a couple of nights for those other measurements, like the Bortle class and the other one, just because you want to make sure, you know, sometimes the moon is up a little bit, or there's a little bit of light, air pollution, and that reflects on the night sky. So just over a couple of months, just going out and looking up and taking those measurements. But really, all it takes is just to look up and be like, where's the dimmest star? And then what star is that? And what, you know, and so really that's all it takes is just to look up and find those dim stars. So it doesn't take very long if you get a nice clear night to do it.
Let's see. So,
both of those sheets had mostly the same questions. So
yeah,
if you think you have covered all your questions, then you probably got good information.
Yeah, I think that's it.
All right. Cool. Well, if you think of anything else, you have my email, so just send me an email and I'll see what I can answer for you. If you look through and you're like, oh, I didn't get a good enough answer on that, then let me know.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
We appreciate your time.
You bet. Thanks.
Thanks a lot.
You bet.